and hopefully I'm not digging myself a hole. I appreciate the presentation, sir. As some of you know, and probably actually most of you don't, but the draft Army strategic plan is coming out. It's going to be discussed at the four-star conference next week and then should be published shortly thereafter. But in there it states explicitly that the way the Army is going to go about achieving the Army strategic plan is through think, learn, analyze, and implement construct. But it goes a little bit further because it then states right after that that it challenges us to do it faster.
Yeah.
And much of what General McMaster just talked about, I think with the collaboration with industry, are some ways for us to get a little bit faster. I think we've made a lot of progress in the think, learn, analyze piece of this through AWFCs, et cetera. But I think the real long pole, at least from my perspective, in the tent is the implement phase. Getting the decision and then getting the capability into the field. The CG, tying back to the CG's talk this morning, I believe that, you know, as he stated, part of the big 6+1 was to focus Army leadership on decisions that have to get made. So we can, if we get focused leadership on the decision, you know, that kind of kicks the ball into the next phase of the operation. And we also discussed, several of the industry reps here talked about some ways to speed up from their perspective, once it gets into their lane, if you will, on how it can speed up on the implementation, you know, the development and the fielding. So I think, we would like to hear, I think all of us, what other things, and we made some changes to 7110 last year. So from an industry perspective, if we could hear from you folks on policy changes, process changes, because I think that's really, I think we're really getting good at coming up with good ideas and justifying those ideas. But it starts slowing down once we start crossing that LD, if you will. So that's my comment, sir. No, I'll also say that in deference to and respect towards, no, respect to the G2, the ASP has a lot of what you saw Tom Pappas' brief, you'll see reflections of in that strategic document. So I think TRADOC has done a real good job of influencing Army.
Thanks, Mark. And for those of you who don't know, Mark Riccio is one of our unsung heroes in ARCIC. He's done tremendous work in really bridging us into the Army staff and to make sure we're working together on some of these key initiatives. You're going to, the team, all of you will hear from Bo Dias on this, and Jim Richardson, who's been charged with really influencing our speed of implementation, our ability to innovate, which we have said, I think the CG may have talked about this, it's the ability to turn ideas into valued outcomes and to be able to do it at a pace faster than determined and adaptive enemies. And so there's a qualitative aspect of it, which I think we're getting pretty good at identifying really that logic trail or establishing that logic trail. But then there's a temporal aspect of it and to do it faster, which we're not as good at. So what, you know, Aristotle said, focus on what you can control and you can make some progress. So what we're trying to do is focus on what we control within requirements. Part of that is writing requirements collaboratively. And so 3 years ago, when Bo was the FD, I called him up from Fort Benning, Georgia, and I said, hey, we've got a problem in infantry brigade combat teams. We don't have mobile protected firepower that can operate with IBCTs in restrictive and urban terrain and ensure their freedom of movement and action in close combat. And so as a result, every offensive operation for our infantry, and we've seen this in Afghanistan in many scenarios, is a movement to defense followed by the application of fires. That sounds like World War I to me, and I think we can do better. And so this was coming out of a lot of our experimentation and our analytical efforts. And I said, what can we do? Well, I think we're thinking of a mobile protected firepower vehicle to provide this kind of capability. And then we embarked on an effort to write that requirements document collaboratively with G8, G3, ourselves at the maneuver center. We used ForceCom and 18th Airborne Corps in particular to bridge even more into the user community. We had AMC representation from a sustainment perspective, and the testing community was involved as well to make sure that we would write it in a way that we could get it faster. It went to a JROC 2 years later after we wrote it, which is crazy. So we really need to figure out where this languished and why it languished. And it is really, it's in the Decker-Wagner report, so much of this stuff. I mean, this problem was the sawtooth problem they talk about in the report. So this was approved really at the four-star level with General Cohn, a TRADOC at the time. And then you know, and then it went to a council of colonels, man. And they redebated all the stuff that was in the ICD. And so, gosh, it's been frustrating. But I think what the chief has done to grip this thing, and obviously the General Ordiano grappled with this as well. But the AROC process is meant to get senior leaders involved in these key areas. Mark mentioned the 6+1 to help focus senior leaders on those capabilities and programs associated with those capabilities that have to be expedited to make sure we can maintain overmatch over enemies and fight and win in the future. So there's a lot we can do from a requirements perspective, and then I'll see where else you want to take the conversation on that. But obviously the panel by Bo and Jim Richardson is going to be, I think, really critical in identifying even more opportunities there. The key thing that Jim Richardson is doing for the chief is that whereas before, I know everybody, I'm sure there are many of you, we talk about like acquisition before and everything, you're just like, oh man, not that again, like that's never gonna happen. But I really think what's different here is that Jim Richardson is developing a plan to innovate faster, as Mark is alluding, is really the key thing. And so it's not just in our study, it's really gonna be a plan with really changes made in the way we're doing business, and specific responsibilities identified and milestones and everything else you expect in a plan. Yes, thanks.
I'm gonna kind of go off of what he said. You know, it's not industry that's going slow, but it's the risk that's causing the military, all of the militaries, not to move fast.
Yeah.
And so if you're willing to take some risks and doing some things instead of in a linear way,
yeah,
if you do it simultaneously,
right,
and take the risk and have a good plan that says I got an off ramp here, I can make a decision here, industry can give you what you want.
Right.
And we can do it fast. We proved it. Not yeah, just us, I'm from Land Systems, but BAE's proved it. Everybody's proved that we can do it if we're willing to take some risks. And so there's some measured risk that you can take.
Yeah.
And we are willing to participate in that. I think every industry guy here and gal would agree. We would like to participate in that risk reduction, but you got to do it fast. Because if you wait 7 to 9 years before you ever see the first thing,
yeah,
you've gone through 2 presidential elections. You've gone through 5 elections for our House of Representatives. You've gone through 2 or 3 chiefs. You go through, I don't know how many TRADOC commanders and everybody else, and they're all doing it at different times, and everybody's got a different focus, and you lose that energy.
Yeah.
You can't afford to lose energy when it's an important program for you. You just can't do it. And right, we're here to help, and we want to, but we got to walk that rope together.
All right, Chris. So just 2 points I'd like to make to reemphasize this. Is that I think one of the key things is we have to obviously get things done faster, and we got to assume risk to be able to do that. We have to sometimes take suboptimal solutions that will improve our capabilities. You know, so for example, you know, just the area that you're working on, which is upgun of the Striker, for example, you know, that is not going to be the optimal solution, right? But it is a solution we can get fast. We can learn from that, and then as we upgun the rest of the fleet, we can adapt that with the additional hatch or whatever whatever else that we want to do to capability. So to recognize that we have to be flexible in our development of solutions so we can improve in a continuous manner and not just say, well, that wasn't in the requirements document or the specs initially or whatever. And I think if we can have that flexibility together, then that will help tremendously. So we don't have to do like some big engineer change proposal to do what makes sense to both of us. I mean, and to incur all the cost associated with that. That's one way, I think, is to get it done fast, take risk initially, but also have a mechanism in place to be able to learn and then continue to evolve it. The second thing I think that is going to be is critical to us is to have a strategy, right? Because what allowed us to get to Striker upgun, as an example, what allowed us to do a number of things that we're doing in the CVMS, the Common Vehicle Modernization Strategy, looking for solutions to LRV and so forth, is that we all agreed that that's the direction we need to head. So is that the ultimate solution for all combat vehicles? No, but we look for an opportunity to begin moving in that direction, to begin to bend the palm and our spending in the direction of where we want it to head. And so that's another I think, key element of it. And then the third thing I would say is that we have to do some things now, but also we need some longer-term development efforts, and I think that is where prototyping comes in. And so there are a couple different models of prototyping, but I think I don't mind prototyping efforts that take us longer to get the ultimate capability, the objective capability, because that's going to inform our requirements over time and allow us to integrate new technologies. So for example, to what kind of future fighting vehicle or mobile protected firepower objective, longer range capability, if we do something short term but also long term, what do we want that objective capability to have integrated into it? Well, we might want some kind of a component of directed energy capabilities, maybe for counter UAS or counter optics or something like that. So we want a different maybe lethality package that takes advantage of some of the improvements in energetics and some of the new systems that we've already developed, like the new 30-millimeter cannon, the XM-A13, for example. We would want some new engineering approaches to protection, like single hull casting, as an example, is one technology. Like independent suspension like the Puma has that can blow off, you know, the suspension and not rely on torsion bars. We want power and energy technologies that reduce logistics demand and allow us to maintain freedom of movement and action in combat vehicles at the end of extended and contested lines of communication in austere environments. We would want active protective systems integrated into the vehicle. We'd probably want onboard power generation. There are all these technologies right now. We don't have a place to put them. We have no place to integrate them. So we need combat vehicle prototyping to do that. I do believe that TARDEC could play a central role in that, and I am totally up for any suggestions you have at making the relationship between TARDEC and industry and the PEO stronger, such that industry doesn't see TARDEC as a competitor and sees TARDEC as a way to co-develop capabilities. Now, we do this all the time with CRADAs and everything else. TARDEC, in prototyping a combat vehicle, I mean, would rely largely on industry for components and doing all that. The other model, of course, is what we've done with Future Vertical Lift, which I think is extremely, I think it's on track and it's going to really pay off. So, I mean, I guess I'm just qualifying your observation. Hey, long term, man, you know, you could lose it. You could lose your ability to get it done. But there are some things that we have to do to maintain overmatch, I think. Because combat vehicles, I think, is a great example. You could pick Puma, Land 400, the Ajax program, a number of combat vehicles out there, and you could say, man, I want that off of that vehicle. I want that off of that vehicle. I want that off of that vehicle. But there is no vehicle that right now that I would buy from somebody else that I would want to put Americans in future close combat. But we can see the technologies today that will give us overmatch. Now, I mean, you know, I love the Bradleys, JP here, man. I love it, man. I love the Bradley. But we are doing important things to improve the current fleets, Bradley and Abrams. But we all know that unless we start something now, we will not replace the Bradley sooner than it becomes obsolete, right? We just know that. So I think the prototyping effort is really key for us. A place to integrate and put those technologies under innovative engineering concepts, and then to do that through, in partnership with our tremendous engineers and scientists within TARDEC in this case, but this applies to CECOM and communications capabilities. This applies across the board, but doing both models maybe, you know, that also the model with industry prototyping like we've got going on with Future Vertical Lift, for example. Absolutely, yeah, exactly. And General Milley's been really driving a lot of this emphasis on prototyping and the acceptance of risk, you know, the ability to work with industry early, you know, with synthetic prototyping as well, you know, and to fail early and as cheaply as we can in some of these key areas.
Sir. I'm Captain Lorenzo Ruiz. I'm at the MBA program here at William & Mary. When we talk about innovation, successful organizations make cuts in order to maximize contributions toward growth opportunities. What are your thoughts on how the Army can make cuts to contribute toward growth?
Okay, all right. Well, I mean, the key thing we've got to do is look across all of our programs and portfolios to recognize, you know, where we're not getting what we need to get from our investments. and begin to divest ourselves of some of those capabilities. In some areas, we're going to have to take risk in the near term to reach long term, and we are taking risk already, I think, in some of the near-term capabilities to be able to invest adequately in long-term capabilities. In terms of what we can divest on in the Army now, I think we're in a difficult situation because a lot of what we've divested from our Army, we're realizing, hell, we need that again. So if you think about, like, what are the problems the Army's facing right now? So I mentioned, I think we're too small. The second problem I'd say is we're too light. We have divested too much of our armored force capability. We did that, I think, based on flawed assumptions about future enemy capabilities, and then we got a wake-up call from what we see in eastern Ukraine. In 1997, 47% of our infantry force was mechanized. We're going down to 16% mechanized when you look at it at the company level. That's crazy, I think, compared to what we see in the world. We know we only have 9 armored brigade combat teams in the active force and 5 in the guard. And I'm not going to go into what wartime demands are, but all 9 of those active force are committed to heel-to-toe rotations to Europe, Korea, and the Middle East. So the Army's too light. I think the Army's out of position. You know, I think what we've learned from Europe is that it's a hell of a lot easier to maintain a deterrent than have to rebuild it after you lost it. And so if you look at the pattern break in Russian behavior, it ought to have been apparent to us from 2007 with the Baltics and the denial of service attacks, but certainly by the invasion of Georgia in 2008. How do we respond? Well, we accelerated our withdrawal from Europe. And now basically we're finding, what do we need in Europe? Well, basically what we had there 5 years ago, you know? So we're in a situation where that out of position is really costing us to need to do more. The other thing is I think we're not integrated enough across all the components. This is an area where we might be able to achieve some economies. The chief is driving us in this direction in terms of looking at how we can better integrate across all components and get more out of the force we have. I think there are more opportunities with roundout that we could look at that could help address multiple of these problems simultaneously. The other problem, though, is that we are vulnerable to enemy disruptive capabilities we've seen on display in Russia and Ukraine. And General Pete Jones, who's leading our Russian New Generation Warfare Study, is the expert at this. But we've divested ourselves of a lot of capabilities we find like we need, okay? So, hey, we're always going to have air supremacy, right? So we can divest of land-based electronic warfare capabilities because the Air Force will do that for us, right? Damn. Russia has established air supremacy over Ukraine from the ground. What do we do now? Well, we need electronic warfare capabilities again. And, you know, we divest ourselves of a lot of our long-range rocket artillery capabilities. Why? Because our Air Force is going to be able to fly CAS missions for us. Well, when you look at A2AD threats and capabilities, you need that long-range fires capabilities just to suppress enemy air defense and get the Air Force in the game to begin with. And then guess what? If you don't have air supremacy, where are the sorties going to go, man? Air superiority. Then where are they going to go? AI. Then what? CAS, bottom of the pecking order right there, you know? So we need our fires capabilities to be enhanced. We got rid of short-range air defense, largely, in the active force in particular. And now what do we have? UAS. How many of us have had to look up and say, damn, is it friendly or enemy? Never, right? I don't think there's anybody old enough to have done that. Not even JB's that old. So now we're recognizing we have to deal with this new range of threats. So I think the problem is, you know, we're working on it. If you have ideas, are you going to work for ARC again when you're done here at William & Mary? All right, man. Start working on it now. So we are looking hard at what to divest. The problem we're in is that end strength is going down to us significantly, and the size of the force across all components. And actually, you know, the demands for capacity and in certain capabilities we already have, and for some new capabilities is going up, right? So. There are some tough choices we're going to have to make, obviously, and I think the Army staff has identified, we've worked with the Army staff to identify some opportunities to reprioritize and take some action against, you know, some of these first order problems. You know, too small, right, too light, out of position, not integrated enough, vulnerable to disruptive technologies, right? And so when you look at these all together, you can start to begin to develop solutions that can address multiple of those problems simultaneously.
That is his project.
That's great. Awesome. Great. Thank you. So I didn't give you an answer to your project, man. You got to come up with that yourself. Go ahead.
General McMaster, Bruce Cordelli from Boeing. Great framework, great structure. Appreciate the comments. Great comments that you've reached out to Dr. Roper and SCO. So my comments will be focused on the think and learn piece.
Yeah.
Motion of industry, you get to the analyze, implement. And the think and learn, how can we in industry help you in the upfront piece? And if we have an event or something we're doing in the upfront piece, how do we collaborate with you using Brad Herndon's, the first definition?
Yeah. Okay, so I think the main thing is to help us understand better what is in the realm of the possible, what's on the horizon, where technology is at a level of maturity where you can see its military application, and then work with us to help integrate that capability, that technological capability, into units and to integrate it with soldiers so it can actually could actually be fielded. And so this is really, I think there's a much bigger role for industry, and I'm going to ask our team to take this on in our O&O work, our operational and organizational concept work. We're working on this right now. So, for example, we have developed draft O&Os for an army of 2030. And I can guarantee you that I'm sure that there are technological capabilities that will be mature well before 2030 that are not represented in that O&O work. And that's because it's our tendency to use what we have today as the basis for what we're writing about the future. So I think in forums like our technology exchange, TIEs, technology information exchanges with industry, I think that what we could do better is provide you access to our concept work in advance. And if we do that across all industry, then it's usually not an issue, right? And then you could say, hey, here's what you're missing in your concepts. Here's what you could potentially do. And then I think it's not just the kind of collaboration we've had in the past, which has been good, but it's really working collaboratively on the O&Os, I think, could bring us to the next level.
HRDF.
And there's Henry right there, man. Yeah. Henry, raise your hand. He's the guy. He's the guy who can help give you access to these O&Os and the concept work. General Lennox.
Hey, HR, thanks. Bob Lennox here for everybody. I don't know how much time you have. This could go on for like 2 days, and I appreciate your willingness to bring it up and have the conversation. It's needed, and it was needed, you know, long ago. So this isn't recent need. I remember a dumb G8 about 5 years ago went to industry at Sterling Heights to talk to them about GCV and started to see the capabilities that they could do in analysis and trade-offs of requirements, so that they could inform the requirements earlier in the process. With that, then went, JB was kind enough to host me at BAE and have a similar kind of discussion. So early on in the process, in your maybe somewhere in the think and some of the learn phase, industry can help shape requirements. Now there's a nervousness about doing that, but if you go to everybody, if you talk to multiple people, I think you can do it, and you certainly learn by the process. So that's one thought, and I apologize for having a couple of them.
Yeah.
But I've got the microphone, so. You mentioned funding. S&T funding is there today, and you guys have fenced it. The money is there today. Ask yourself what you're getting out of it, and ask yourself where that money's going to. Front row here started talking about labs, TARDEC, SIRDEC, AMRDEC, and what are you really getting out of those? And are they more like state-run communist industries, or are they providing you the capabilities that you want? Money's there. So I think you can build prototypes today instead of paying for manpower. I think you'd find that you could be better served. Final point, I'll quit, is a comment was made earlier about speed, and I thought that was unbelievably to the point. When you talk about 7 or 8 years, Mike talked about having 8 years or 9 years, two administrations to attack it. You give the Navy and the Air Force 8 or 9 years to steal your funds, and they will. If you can go faster by using directed requirements, ONS, that's where we've had success in the last 10 or 15 years. And if you look at the Decker-Wagner report, I know you have, you only need JSIDs for the top, ACAT-1D, your next future vertical lift. You can move much more adroitly underneath that and go faster. And I think if you start to put demands on OSD and on Congress, industry can help you. So those are some thoughts.
No, that's all really great feedback. And then what we make sure is we capture our team is going to capture this conversation moving into our funding. So on working with our work on how to get faster. On combat vehicles, you know, I think Paul Rogers is really gripping this and moving forward with it. And Eric Wesley, the MCOE commander, along with Don Sando and our normal team down there, Willie Knuckles, Pete, and now John Koloszewski, are really focused on advancing this now, along with some of the other key initiatives like the Squad Foundation Decisive Force, improving squad lethality, mobility, reach, you know, some of the capabilities like XM25, LMAM capabilities that we want to get into our squads to improve the squad's reach and ability to overmatch the enemy in close combat. The 40-millimeter long flying flying grenade or munition, you know, that can defeat, you know, the overmatch enemies that have sacks full of RPGs, right? Which is we've had problems with these days. So I think that we can work with industry across all these key initiatives with the leadership involved on the S&T funding. I agree with you. I think there's an opportunity to move more of the funding into 6.4 money and to begin to really do the prototyping work that can help us, you know, inform requirements quickly and then get capabilities into the force a lot faster. Obviously, all of our labs they're pretty enthusiastic. The ones I've talked to are enthusiastic about that as well. And this is something we really just have to, to work on. And then the ONS, I mean, I think it's the ONS, certainly, and then what we've been able to do, I think, more effectively than in recent years because of the, I guess, change in environment and so forth, is to have a better, stronger relationship with Army Service Component Commands, and then those Army Service Component Commands understand their role to liaise with the J-8 and the Combatant Commands. And so what we're seeing now is Army capabilities showing up on Combatant Command integrated priority lists, whereas before, you know, it wasn't really happening with any degree of consistency. So I agree. Those are great points. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, sir. Yes.
I have a question for you. This is going to be a revisit, and so it's a bit of a checkup. You and I have had this conversation for the last several years, and we're not going to talk about the requirements generation process because we're not here to fix JSIDs and work with what we got, but the requirements management process, and that's to the couple of points. So I was just wondering if you might give us a little bit of an update on how you're influencing from your chair, where you directly affect the requirements management process once they've been generated, because I think there's some lessons to be learned from our brethren in the Marine Corps and the McCitic, where they don't suffer two ills that we seem to do, that may be part of what we can do to speed things up, which is they don't wrestle with unobtainium very much.
With what, I'm sorry?
Unobtainium.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're not that deep. They also don't suffer might as well-itis. So we don't have issues with, well, if we're doing this, we might as well do this too. And I think maybe one of the things that we've talked about is in the requirements management process, let's just focus on the KPPs. You know, I don't think the Marines know what a KSA or an AA is. That just confuses the issue. So maybe, and I know we've talked about requirements, are you able to do things in ARCIC on the requirements management part of it that might help facilitate that speed, you know, because that's a big part of how you're gonna get there to help industry, and he's brought it up, and yeah. Maybe there are some things that you're doing on the requirements management process, because I know they're generating quickly. The guys at MCOE now are doing a great job at cranking them out. That's not the issue. It's how we manage it along the way through the discovery at the AWAs and so on.
Okay, I'll take a first crack at that, then I'll ask you if you could just bring the mic up to General Dias quickly, because I know that you'll have more information on this as well. So one of the key things is collaboration at the beginning of the requirements process and writing the requirement with input from the entire team, with an emphasis really on the testing community, you know, for example, who can say, hey, you know, if you write the requirement that way, it's going to take, you know, an incredible amount of time to, you know, to test this. Why don't you write it this way? You get the same capability you want. But it's much easier to test, for example. That's one easy thing we can do. The other key thing we've been emphasizing is the identification of threshold and objective requirements, you know, for anything that we're writing, so that we can incentivize, I think, our partners in industry in particular to exceed really what we want and integrate the latest technologies, but also that we can not complicate the effort with unobtainium. I have not seen an example. If you have, please let me know. of us writing an unobtainable requirement lately. I think if the trend is in any direction, it's actually, you know, we've reduced it to a degree that I think we might be at risk at incentivizing the delivery of old technologies, you know, I think that we've got to figure out what the right balance is, obviously, but I think that, you know, you should not see an FCS-like, you know, aspirational document out of us, and if you do, please let us know. The other key thing is for the team remaining together throughout the whole process and leadership being involved, right? So McCitic and the Marine Corps, I think, can be effective in certain areas, and they've had their own issues, as you guys know, over recent years, like we did too. But what they're able to do is they're able to keep a smaller number of leaders on the same page for longer. And so we have to work harder because our Army is bigger and our will as an institution is more diffuse, right, as a result of that. So what the Chief has done in involving commanders in the AROC process, I think, is extremely important. And then I think that will allow us to speak with one voice and to be able to prioritize and then move out without second and third guessing. I mean, we want to do the analysis up front, not charge in a certain direction, but I think those things will help. And then the requirements and the acquisition and the sustainment community and the Army staff staying involved together across the whole process. Because you know we're going to be making trades and throughout the whole thing. And we can't just write a requirements document, throw it over the divider and say, hey, will you guys deliver on that for us? And I think the biggest thing we could do is to make sure that we identify the teams that have to collaborate in critical areas in a sustained manner by name, email address, and make them introduce themselves to each other. So what I'm talking about, for example, is the relevant PMs and PEO C3T connected with our guys at Gordon, which they are, but connected with us at ARCA, we've done this through the Mission Command Refinement effort. We've pulled the whole team together. But we've got to sort of institutionalize that. And sometimes what I'll hear is like, hey, I've got this great solution from a PM or a PEO, but I don't have a requirement for it. I mean, that drives me crazy. I want to say, well, but do you have a phone? You know what I mean? Why don't you just call the requirement? Call me, and I will write the requirement that day. Just dictate it to me. So I think if we have that kind of collaboration going on, we can turn things faster, and we can be more effective across requirements and the bridging into an acquisition strategy. But
yes, sir. Thanks. The Marine Corps has got one PEO. They have multiple PMs. That's one difference, right? Also, McCitic is probably closer to a tie to a FD plus ARCIC kind of situation where they're able to do programming recommendations, and they also work requirements. So that is, as extension of the Army staff, that's one way we're attempting to address that. Another is... you have requirements documents, but they're also translated into our request for proposals. And I think that is an area of risk, is a danger area, at Ranger School, in which you turn a 41-page CPD into a 375-page request for a proposal, in which the chief last week said, hey, there's probably three things he's going to look after, particularly in relationship to our Big Six plus one. And he added one more. So the one that he added was the modular handgun. He was going to pay particular attention to buying down at Cabela's, which is tongue-in-cheek. So, but future vertical lift, combat vehicles, and cross-domain fires, what he mentioned specifically. And this AROC, I can't under-emphasize the importance that it's going to have to us, because the chief... We haven't had in-person AROCs for 6 or 7 years. They've all been paper. And so this is the chief of staff and the vice chief of staff meeting every week to talk about some aspect of acquisition. And you really haven't seen that level of interest of those people in this. And this has to do a little bit with, McCain's language and the ATL activity that's going on right now, so that his involvement in this AROC with ATEC there, and I'll just tie back to what the boss said, Dan Carpler is in every AROC. And so when he looks at an ICD and says, hey, I'm going to have, I've got some issues I've got to deal with, like cyber testing. How do you test cyber, for example? Those are things that he's got his guys now working on in relationship to acquisition, because he's going to be part of the solution. The ATEC guys are, and DOT. Sir?
Thanks, Bob. Okay, great.
Thanks, sir, for coming down and talking to us. Sir, you mentioned the TIE, the technology information exchanges. With the four-step process that you have, you may want to relook TIE and turn it into a capability information exchange for them. Because especially with the analytical capabilities that industry can bring to bear, we need a venue to better come in and talk to you and your leadership about those analytical capabilities and how they can affect and enhance, you know, what you're doing in-house already.
That's a great suggestion. Let's do that, Henry. We'll just make it capability and technology or capability integration exchange, and then what that'll do is it'll key us toward what we should provide you up front, even before the, you know, before the session. I think that's an area we can improve as well. Is like get you what we see as our biggest problems, right? Get you the sort of a condensed version of our capabilities needs assessment, you know, where we see the biggest gaps and highest priority solutions. And then the work that we've done under the warfighting challenges, obviously, and through learning. And then the O&Os, as I mentioned, the ones that are mature and that we can make publicly available that you could help us critique and improve. That'd be great. Thank you. This was a great session. Thanks for the great questions and comments and recommendations. Thank you.
Okay, sir, I know you've got somewhere you got to be real quick, but